Okay, welcome everybody to be here again. I need to do some translation into Chinese because two of the panelists probably don't understand English. The first one, as you know, is Rebecca Chen. Some of the official things I know is she's a chairwoman of the Baijia Education Group and CFT of Manpower Development Agency. So for me, she is a great teacher. She's a great educator. She's a book writer as well. She's been writing several books, including Coaching Entrepreneur Leaders, Good Family Better Than Good School. I believe so as well. 12 Modes to Destroy Child. So she's been really busy doing the book writing. 她在先后出版了不同的书，有企业领导训练、好家庭生活好学校，非常棒。百家亲密空间，还有摧毁孩子的十二个模式。我对她的最重要的问题是 ，What actually motivates you to start education in business? And now you have Stephen besides you. You actually lured him from the juicy VC world to the education. Do you have some stories to share? 我的问题是，一开始是什么让你，什么样的事情让你进入教育的呢？而且，Steven这么棒，他原来在做一些 VC
的事情，现在你也把它一起带来做教育，你有什么故事想要跟我们分享吗？人都会追求最大意义和最大价值的事情。当我做了十多年的教育之后，我发现，教育，这个事情。 是最大价值和意义。十年树木，百年树人。人的教育的话呢，是艰苦的工程。我觉得需要有献身精神才能可以做好教育。然后我们所看到的所有问题，无论是社会问题、家庭问题，总之你说得出来的所有问题，在我看来都是教育的问题。 因为教育没有解决到它，问题才会出现。所以，我觉得要去做这个。
I think actually the most of the social problems or the environment problems, all of them are really is the problem of education. It's an education problem. So I think it's the most meaningful things for me to do is to do education, and I also think that for the last 14 years, I bring a lot of training to adults and companies, but for the teenagers, the next generation is the most meaningful things to do.
Okay, thank you very much. Sitting besides Rebecca is Stephen. So Stephen is the CEO of the Baijia Education Company right now, right? Okay, so question for you, Stephen, is how do you, I know probably you really enjoy working with your mom, and so what's the decision to make you working for education as well? After such a nice graduation, education from England and the different places.
Yeah, actually, I got my master's degree in UK, University of Bath, which is the toughest business school in UK. And after that, I came to a VC company in Shenzhen. It's a QF capital. This company invested around 200 startups in China, which is really a good place to work. But actually, last year, my mother kept convincing me about her dream, about her value, and her purpose of life, then I should be cooperative with her and support her ideas. And really, for the rest of her life, I will support her. Yes.
Okay, thank you. I think they're really a good model for us as well. We have such a really good parenting relationship. Oh, next is for Wang Fushan 老师. Okay, let me just introduce him a little bit. He has a long bio, but just make it short. He's the founder, chairman, and CEO of Xiaofeibao. That's a consumer protection. If you don't know what is it, it's a very big customer service platform established between customers as well as enterprises. So customer can encounter any problems, they can report over there. Consumer can see the warnings, and enterprise can actually some to use some of the data from the tech to guide them. So the question for him is, as a very busy and a successful entrepreneur, and you have a built such value-added platform, when you having a successful and demanding job, so what actually bring you here to the family and education panel? 我来翻译，那我来讲，用中文来讲一下好了。王福山老师的事业是非常成功的，他的这么大的一个平台，然后工作其实是非常忙碌的。那你今天为什么？而且你的工作是非常需要你的，非常忙碌，非常需要你。那今天你为什么跟我们坐在了一起，要讨论教育和家庭的价值呢？
大家好啊，我们今天呢之所以能做到一块，是因为百家教育呢是我们作为消费保在教育领域第一个消费保障的一个项目。什么是消费保障呢？可能在美国呢，大家可能没有太多的这方面的烦恼，但是呢，在中国国内的话，现在的在消费者的保护方面，我们还有很多的东西是要第三方去做的。
Actually, SVEF is a company that protects consumers, consumer rights. And then actually, Baijia Education is our first company in education industry that will really protect the rights of the consumers of Baijia Education.
因为我们经常来美国人都会有一个对比。 就是在美国的话，如果你消费某一样东西的话，你是不用担心后面会有一些服务方面的问题的。比如说，我有一个朋友，他说他在美国买了一双登山鞋，用了差不多一年了，但是他穿得很少。第三次去爬山的时候，发现这个鞋子有点问题，那打给商家，人家马上就说你过来，我可以给你退掉或者换掉。但这种现象目前中国是不可能的。
We always compare the consumer rights differences between US and China. And actually in China, the consumer rights is really, really, really weak. And compared to US, I can raise an example that one of my friends, he bought a pair of shoes to climb hills that actually, when he really found the problem about his shoes, it's already 1 year later of buying these shoes. But he still can't get a good protection of his consumer rights, but it cannot really happen in China.
所以呢，这个中国的政府也意识到，说这个目前我们强调消费升级，其实消费的升级就是整个中国服务行业的一个升级。所以我们也一直在帮助中国的市场监管总局在处理他们这个整个社会的消费的数据分析。 那我们通过数据分析呢，选择一些优秀的企业，为他们提供消费保障的服务。
And at this moment, the Chinese government also perceives the problem of consumer rights as we are really at the stage of consumption upgrading at this moment. But how to upgrade the consumption? To protect the consumer rights is the big part, significant part of this. So. We actually serve a lot of big companies to help them, to serve them with the consumer rights, to help them to protect the customers that really can get good service and good products.
所以呢，我们通过这个对百家教育的系统的分析、大数据的一些调查，然后呢，我们觉得百家教育在这个教育这个领域是属于在服务各方面。 做得比较好的，所以我们愿意跟他一起来推动，让这个中国的消费者在百家教育的这个消费的过程中有充分的保障。
And after investigating the Baijia Education, we found that this company really meet the obligations and the rights to protect the consumer rights, to take the responsibilities. So we like to cooperate with Baijia Education to push this. Business all around the world, the environment all over China.
而且大家也看到了 ，Stephen 是百家最有说服力的产品，所以我们愿意跟他一起来做这个事情。
And really, Rebecca is very experienced in family education, and she can really help the families of China.
Wait, so next is John. John has a lot of fancy titles, but really amazed me is John is very fluent, and I tested today in Chinese, as well as English, maybe something else as well, I guess. Could be. Okay, I haven't tested it, because I only know two. So John is CEO of China Israel Science Technology Innovation Center, has more than 20 years of experience in Greater China region as an investment consultant, financial advisor, assets management, and investment industry. She is also teacher, speaker, coach as well, I think. Of course, you are co-founders of different prestigious management, wealth management companies. Welcome, John. I think you can add a lot of things from your perspective. You have very interesting U.S. background, China background, and you know China very well. You travel around a lot. And you also have the VC background. From your unique perspective, what do you think you can bring to education?
Oh, okay. Well, let's see. I actually don't have a lot of experience in investing in education. However, after coming in contact with Rebecca here and the Bai Jia Jia, we felt that this is a very, very good opportunity. And that there's a very important niche market here because there's a big difference really in the education markets in the US and in the East, especially in China. Where someone with a coaching background like Rebecca, who she's developed maybe close to 20,000 students in the past 15 years, they're all owners of small to medium-sized businesses, and some of them are very large, very successful business owners, like Mr. Wong. So I discovered that they all very respect this woman a lot. And she's very different than, a lot of these coaches, training kind of gurus in China, you know, where it becomes in English. Anyway, okay. So really, I think it's more about investing in people. And we see a very good opportunity here. And it's a really good opportunity to do something that we think is helpful inside the home as well. And so this year we signed an agreement, along with them, and we'll be creating an education ecosphere, which is also focused around the home, and which has a online, electronic kind of a learning, high-tech twist to it as well. Okay, so we believe that, obviously the more successful that they are at this, it's going to be a really great thing. And I think that the key is helping parents to spend a little bit more of their time in a way that will that can reflect on to the success of their children, getting them to use the skills that they should be learning, or they should be internalizing as business leaders in their own home. So we wish them the very best of luck, and that's my two bits. There you go.
Thank you very well. Yeah, very much. Dr. Scott Carpenter. So I have known him for some time, and he has very interesting background over here as well. 30 years of atomic. Did I pronounce it right?
Physics,
yes. System modeling experience in parallel with 20 years of education research. So my question to you, Dr. Scott, is you experience expand from nuclear submarine, which is very fancy for me, and Lawrence Research Lab and education, and published many different papers. What triggers you to start study for the human acquisition of new understanding? And you have something regarding the age of artificial intelligence. And what triggers you to think about what's that impact to the kids as well?
Because this is an entrepreneurs conference, there are two areas that I see opportunities in regard primarily to teaching children how to have vision and wisdom, and teaching adults how to take advantage of the coming age of artificial intelligence. My experience in complex systems, and then building knowledge and wisdom management systems in private industry made me very concerned about our education system. In the United States, the system is essentially 160 years old. It's bottom up. Learn information, learn knowledge, work in a factory. You listen to the boss tells you what to do. But soon, machines will handle information and knowledge as easily as they handle data today. Humans cannot compete with the machines. So our education system needs to be turned upside down. We should start at the top. Teach our children to have purpose and vision. Teach them how to set goals, how to make wise decisions when they find the solutions to those goals. And that's where I believe children should be taught in schools today. Now, there's not really going to be any major changes in the United States education system or the world's education system, because AI is knocking on the door right now. And you know, global powers are competing desperately with each other right now to lead or control this new AI world. Now, AI is like a subject matter expert, except it will be a subject matter expert in all topics. So it will integrate solutions that are interdisciplinary in a way that all the subject matter experts, the human subject matter experts, cannot do. So the main point is we need to educate our children to think top down. If you learn bottom up in school, then you become a bottom up worker. We need people who stand on top of knowledge at the wisdom and vision layer. So I study, I've been experimenting for 5 years now on how you can implement top-down courseware into the classroom, math, physics, English, history. And I find that beginning at around second grade level, children can understand any concept that an adult can understand. Now the current system treats them like children all the way up. Second grader, third grader, fourth grader. We need to start treating them much more respectfully than that. Okay, I see a big opportunity in those who can develop the material to teach children how to be top down, teach the vision and the goal setting layer. The other issue is, in the 2020s, maybe 2025, maybe sooner, when we have ubiquitous artificial intelligence all over the world, and the AI will know all that is known. The AI will create more knowledge through inference, and that'll all be available for people. When a person gives a goal to the system, the AI system of the future, the AI will bring all the best solutions. The person will then need to know how to make the right decision. Now, this also means there could potentially be mass unemployment, and you've all heard about that. So the other opportunity that I see is how do people who design something called decision support systems design the interfaces for humans to interact with the AI of the future? And one little side note, I'd like to speak frankly about what Catherine and Rebecca do. They don't just want to help students make it through Eastern or Western education system. They also want to educate the parent about how they should be mentoring their children through that process. Now, I've had enough children that I've been teaching one-on-one, and I find that in the Eastern culture, I'm going to speak frankly, fathers need to play a bigger role in their children's lives, especially with the boys. I have mothers grabbing my shirt, begging me to help them with their sons because they're having trouble. So I hope Xi Jinping sends the message to the fathers, have a relationship with your children. Don't leave it to the mother.
Okay, thank you. You answered a lot of the questions I'm going to ask in the future, but really well, very well said. So next question is open for all the panel speakers to talk about from your experience. Do you see China and U.S. family education have some differences? If yes, what are things you have seen? 中美之间的家庭教育有什么样的区别？你们看到之后，你有什么不同的例子吗？ Just any.
Generally speaking, I mean, I've lived in China for a better part of 27 years now. And I come from a very large family, so I'm the oldest of 12. My mom and dad have 12, and several of my siblings were all, probably about a third of them, were all homeschooled. So I think I have a fairly, good perspective on both sides. It should be fairly fair. But there's a difference, I would say, that, you know, Chinese are much more focused on education as far as the school and academic results are concerned. I would say that both societies really, from the family standpoint, are really, I wouldn't say defunct, but I would say that there's a lot of there's a lot of room for improvement on both sides, you know, of course. Chinese see American education as being more open, more creative, and whatnot like that. Obviously, Chinese kids, they end up getting, I have my two youngest kids are going to Chinese and English school right now, okay? So I can tell you, the kids in the purely international program at their school, it's a very hard school to get into. My kids got into it because the director of the school was my Chinese 201 teacher in university, okay? So otherwise, they wouldn't have gotten in. I went there, and it was time for them to get into school, and he says, all right, bring them in, and they got in. And it wasn't until a year later I realized that there's a waiting list of, 100 kids for every class, you know? But the international part of the school, the kids get out of school at 2, they're home by 3 o'clock, and they're playing. And the kids in the Chinese program, my kids, okay, my two younger kids, one's in fourth grade, one's in third grade, bless their souls, I feel so bad for them. They don't get home till 6 o'clock at night, and then they have homework that sometimes they don't get done until 11 o'clock at night. Okay, so it's a big difference. There's really a big difference. So, I mean, you know, how if you could take the, and people look at the bad part of the American system and the bad part of the Chinese system, but if you could take the good part of both and stick them together, you'd really have something pretty amazing.
Absolutely, okay. I totally agree.
我给大家讲一下，我刚从这个西雅图过来旧金山。 那在西雅图负责我们的接送的一位司机，刚好是新的移民，从中国大陆移到美国来。然后呢，他的女儿呢，今年刚刚考上纽约大学，那他就跟我讲了中美两国他所感受到的教育上面的在小孩教育方面的一个差距。他说了一句话，我印象特别深刻。他说他女儿当时来到美国的时候呢，这个数学基本上可以。 不用读，在班里都是考A的，就是中国的基础教育、应试教育呢做得呢很好，但是呢，中国的小孩呢一般不愿意去学校，因为他们觉得学校是一件很痛苦的事情，学习的压力特别大。Before
I'm here, I was in Seattle, and my driver is a Chinese, and he's a new immigrant to U.S. and he told me that his daughter just got into University of New York, and he can tell the difference between the China education and the U.S. education. The China education is have really strong fundamental knowledge about, let's say, maths or physics or some other subjects.
然后他说，他女儿来到美国以后呢，特别爱去学校，因为学校很好玩，学习压力也不大，而且他说到中美两国当中教育。 最大的一个差异可能在于，美国人的教育呢比较实用化，就是会教你很多中国人叫数字教育的方面的东西，而中国的教育呢基本上就是望子成龙的应试教育，就会让你呢一定要考好、学好，只有考上好的大学才是你唯一的一个出路，而美国他在这一方面可能没有那么大的压力，去强调小孩一定要读得很好或者怎么样子。
他们强调的是比较实用的，对他人生有帮助的一些东西。 And when the driver's daughter got into the U.S. high school, and his daughter can compare the differences between the school in China and the school in U.S., and she said, actually, I like U.S. high school because it's more relaxing. And the things that I learned is more practical than when I was in China. And she also said, in U.S., people don't really care about the very high score that, like in Chinese family, like pushing all their kids to have high scores, high grades, to get into best universities. But actually in US, you can choose what is practical for you and what is more meaningful to somebody. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Since we just talked about different problems and issues, including AI age is coming, and also maybe fathers sometimes disappear from the family, and kids' education is very important for all of us. We have seen the issues, have seen the problems, the question for the entrepreneurs on the stage, all of you entrepreneurs. From here, what different opportunities you have seen that you think can set up business in both China and in U.S.? 我来翻译一下我的问题，就是刚刚我们讨论到了一些问题，其中包括AI时代的到来，包括有的时候父亲的在家庭的缺失，包括有的时候孩子是最重要的一件事情，可是孩子已经抑郁了，家长都不知道等等这样子的问题，就这样的问题就会造成一些新的机会。我现在给大家的问题是，在这样的情况下，什么样子的你觉得会给中国和美国带来什么样的在教育方面什么样的机会呢？百家老师可以回答一下吗？其实，在我们中国的话呢，他们都会承认这个应试教育是不好的，可是呢，现状又很难改变。
Actually, all the people in China, including government, they all admit that the education system now in China is bad because all the people are focused on the examinations and the results, grades and things.
那大家知不知道为什么知道应试教育不好又很难改变的原因是什么吗？ 大家知道吗？
And it is difficult to change. And does everybody know, anybody know that why it's so difficult to change, although they really know about the bad things of the education system now in China?
这是一个平等，让所有人在这个应试考试面前平等，然后可以去到下一个的人生的位置。唯一就是说，对孩子来说。 对家庭来说，在社会中的一个平等。And
I can see that it's some kind of equation for all the people in the society of China that they can reach to the next or higher stage of their life through education only. This is the only way for them to reach the higher caste in the society.
所以，短时间内应试教育是很难改变。 于是呢，机会是什么？其实我觉得我自己是看到了如何让孩子不要有这么大的学习的压力，而用这么多的时间去死记硬背，而接受一种训练。这种训练完了之后，会超越那些接受了强烈的这个课外补习或者是大的压力的那些孩子，让他们 轻松的可以适应这个应试的考试。So
what I think is the method we do is to not really pushing the child to learn, not really force them to get more practice, to do more practice solution, do more examination papers, but by really with our method to motivate them to get higher scores. That's the power deep inside in their hearts that they want to win. They want to win this exam. They want to get into that university, but not by pushing or forcing.
也就是说，我们会用对企业的一个训练，来给到孩子，激发孩子的愿景。 责任和使命，使他考试是他的一个他要挑战的，一个他要去挑战的东西，以至于使得他的话呢，透过这个挑战，他会成长很多他生命的品质。
Therefore, we implemented our training for business culture to our child, to our children, to let them have the vision, the mission of their life, like the company do, the company does. When the children, when our kids have their own vision, have their own mission, they can really have power in heart to motivate them to work hard on studying.
我有一个学员，他有18所课外补习班。
One of my student, adult student, he has 18 institute of helping students get higher scores.
可是他告诉我，其实补习对孩子作用不大，伤害很大。
And he says the overtime exercise or the extra exercise for student to get higher scores or the practice is really non-useful.
所以如果让我来看的话呢，就是如果这个机遇就是如何可以让孩子激发他内在的这种力量，让他愿意学习，吃苦学习，同时他可以接受应试考试的这一套的这种训练的体系。
And the training we bring to the teenagers is to let them have the vision, the goal of life, their mission, and then to motivate them from their heart, that let them to learn and to get high scores, to go to the university they want. Because when the teenagers can get into the top university, they can really realize their dream.
就像一个士兵。他为什么可以接受超凡的别人不能接受的训练，一个士兵。
Like a soldier, why he can tolerate the most tough training and the most strict training in his life? Why?
所以我们用了八年的时间去研发这套系统，从线上线下。其实我想说的就是这套系统里边一定是激发孩子的这种欲望，而且快乐、主动、负责任。
I think for the soldiers, because they have honor, they have the value of their life, they have missions that they can tolerate the most tough training in the world. But for our kids, we can bring them to set their goal, their mission of life, and let them to really work hard.
如果说机会的话，我认为这是一个很好的一个机会。
And the chance, I think, that the U.S. Education, family education style, the differences of the business culture, corporate culture to train our child, that will be a good business opportunity for us.
Very good. So we almost run out of time. I'd like to give all the speakers just give one sentence.Before we close today's panel, something you really like the audience to take home. 因为我们的时间已经到了，我希望给每一个人说一句话的机会，把从 Scott Carpenter 开始说一句话，让你的观众可以记住，可以带回去的东西。Just one sentence, okay?
We want our children to be the master of the machine, not the slave. One way to do this is to allow the child to use the machine to solve big problems, not little tiny ones like we do. Children should not be thinking in the terms of single point solutions. They should be thinking, their unit of thought should be in solution spaces. So we need to embed the student in modeling of complex systems. And we can do that with spreadsheet technology in grade school even. I do it in my experiments.So let's let the child be the master of the machine, not the slave. Boys play games till 3 o'clock in the morning. Girls are on their phone 24/7. So we need to teach them that the technology is a tool, not just for entertainment.
Okay, yeah. So I would say we are really keen on getting business leaders to invest back into their homes, into their kids, and take on their kids as their most important, their truly their most important projects. Yep.
中国已经放开了二胎，这对在座的各位关心中美交易的机会人，未来是一个巨大的机会。
From Mr. Wang, and he said, now the Chinese government allows people to have the second child. So it's a big business opportunity for all of us to care about the next generation.
我想说的就是哈，做到现在大家还没有走，会不会是对教育有这种情怀和感这个兴趣哈？如果是，我相信你们也有很多的教育的方式和方法。如果想要在中国也实现你们教育的梦想的话呢，欢迎找我跟我合作。
Welcome to all guys. Come to me and let's discuss about education. And I believe when you're still here, you must be really interested in education. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.